audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
3, 2, 1, go.
Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-840-4051. Dr. Bruce is a board-certified physician. He's an addiction medicine specialist. He does tattoo removal from gang members. Mainly those weird crosses they have in between their forefinger and thumb, and the classic teardrop is also one of his specialty removal items.
Well, I was thinking about the swastika on your butt, and I'm still not ready to do that. But
I'm keeping that
in case I'm raped by white supremacists. I can score some points. I figure he'll go easy.
I think that would be more arousing to him.
Oh, really?
They'd be like, mother of pearl. Yeah.
You may be right.
Yeah, that's the mother load right there for white supremacists.
Speaking of load, Bobcat Goldthwait is our guest tonight. Bob.
It's me, Bob Scratch Goldfarb.
Bob Scratch is going to be at the Irvine Improv.
Irvine Improv. So everybody in the other 73 markets that this show comes to, please, we got party buses coming in from Detroit.
Charter your flights now, everybody, because
Most of your guests
Saturday, Sunday,
are promoting an album or a latest film. I'm promoting a bar gig. Kind of sad, isn't it?
Bob's going to be at Arby's in Conejo. He's going to be signing napkins. You may want to get there on
Thursday.
Very excited.
I got the boat show with David Hasselhoff coming up.
Hasselhoff, well, you're putting yourself in some pretty good company there.
Meet Bobcat and the Night Rocker.
Go Bob Denver and Bobcat.
Bob Denver, yeah.
All right, Bobcat is here. Bob is not only a friend, but soon to be a colleague. Bob is a fine director. A lot of people don't know that about Bobcat. Not only has he done Shakes the Clown, but he's done some videos. You may remember the Aquabats.
And I just finished directing for Julie Brown, that show Strip Mall.
Oh, right. What'd you do, a few episodes?
No, I did like that, and now I go off to back to Man Show.
Yes. Mm. Bob directed some of the more memorable Man Show I guess you'd call them roll-in pieces or field pieces last year, and this time he's going to be back full-time. So.
We had did they air the one with when we stretched the penis around the block?
Yeah, I think we've aired that. That was the send-up on Porky's.
Yeah, so we, so there's a script, and then, basically my job is I kiss your ass. I go, you did it again, Adam!
Genius.
Genius!
Mazel tov.
Genius!
Yeah, that's what
happens. That's what I do for a living.
Yeah, filled in, and he was a guest about 8 years ago, and I was talking to him before the show about kids. I said, boy, this guy's such a nice guy. And the show starts, and all of a sudden he goes into this rant.
Yeah, and then I'm a big guy.
He goes, where's Dr. Drew?
Yeah, I know.
He goes, on a bloody rectum by the end of the show.
Something like that, yeah.
That's good radio, Bruce.
Bruce, I was going to go easy on you until you brought us down. I had some humorous anecdotes and then came to a grinding halt. No, I like your Bruce and everything, but it's 1976. I'm on The Tonight Show and they go, Joey Bishop's there. It's not going to be Johnny.
Yeah.
I go, I like Joey. He's funny. You know, I do like Joey Bishop.
I know, but he's no Johnny.
So, no, the evil story is there's this fake penis that we stretch around the block, and you got, you know, and
that's a Man Show bit we did, by the way.
And it goes around a cactus, you know, and, like, I had a few gags that weren't officially approved.
Right.
And then one of the gags was the penis has been so stretched out that there's some children skipping rope with it.
Right. Yeah. That's right. Yeah, that was good.
That was, like, where, the whole crew was just, like, going, man, you're the devil. You're going to go to hell.
Bob also makes a cameo now and again in the Man Show, too, as the vomiting transient.
Wino.
And Wino.
We can't get extras. Give me the idea of the kind of budget Comedy Central just peels out over there.
He's got range. All right, so Man Show on right now on Comedy Central, by the way, and Bobcat coming up this weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Irvine Improv, and then all over the country still doing stand-up dates, so look for him in a town near you. And Bruce, anything to say? Are we going?
I think
it's
a conflict of interest to mention your show while LoveLine's on.
Thank you.
Okay,
Seth.
Yeah.
19. What's up?
I can't touch a girl for 2 years.
I see. Were you in prison?
No.
Restraining order? What happened?
Well, I can't touch any girl for 2 years.
Why not? Where are you going? What, are you a Mormon?
Yeah, I'm a Mormon.
You going on a mission?
Yeah, I'm on one.
Wow, that's pretty good.
That is pretty good,
Does it say it on there? Wow, I didn't even read the screen.
You're a Mormon and you're calling Loveline for advice.
It's like...
I think there's an inherent problem there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so how many women were you touching before you became Mormon?
I wasn't really touching many. I've always been Mormon.
Yeah.
But, like, before I came on a mission...
Yeah.
You know, I was touching, like... I had this goal to, like... get with one girl, you know, a night, or one girl every weekend before
sure.
I left.
Well, that's the Mormon code, isn't it?
But where's your mission? I mean, like, it's not like South Beach, is it?
No, there's not many hot girls where I'm at. It's all cold.
Where are you going?
I'm in Alaska.
That's where your mission is?
Yeah.
And who do you spread the good news to in Alaska? Caribou and stuff? I mean, who's over there to hear your words?
There's a few people up here, a bunch of skiers. And
what do? Do you ride a bike from door to door? Do you use a snowmobile or
actually,
you mush?
We're pretty hooked up here. We got cars.
Oh, really? Cars now?
Yeah.
I know we're allowing them to have cars in Alaska.
Yeah, in Alaska.
All right. So listen, what the hell are you doing being a Mormon when rape is your true love?
Oh, no. Rape isn't my thing.
Well, it's not.
No.
Well, listen, you don't sound like a good Mormon. Maybe you ought to forget about it.
Oh, no.
Well, what do you think you're going to hear?
Yeah, what do you want?
You think he's a bishop in your church or what?
No, listen, it's not like that.
Okay,
it's
Seth, here's the bottom line. If you know, being a member of a church doesn't have anything to do with spirituality. If your spirituality, your relationship with your God is supposed to fill certain needs and to direct your behavior. And if you are having such a conflict with... you know, being physical with women and you're not finding any solace from your belief system or any help in dealing with your boundaries there, then you really need to reassess your belief system and how you're dealing with what it tells you. It's not like you have a bunch of rules you follow. There's supposed to be a relationship with God, and that's supposed to help you.
Right, and it does.
All right, listen, goofball. One word, Santeria. That may be two words.
Adam sent some chickens.
He needed like go paper instead of scissors when they're doling out the missions, man. Because
yeah.
Some of these guys get sweet missions. They go to Spain and stuff. All right, who's next?
All right, let's talk.
I like
to,
when you see two white guys in white shirts and Watts driving their bicycles around.
Yeah.
How are they going to?
Is
that the Latter-day Saints?
They got screwed. Katie?
Hi.
You're 17.
Yeah.
What's up?
I'm nervous.
Well, there's a lot of things for that.
I'm nervous too, so.
Go ahead.
My best guy friend, I've known him for like 4 years, and I've pretty much like been in love with him since like the first day I met him. And he started going out with my cousin a while ago, and then he moved out of state, and so like he gave her a promise ring, and like I don't want that to happen.
You said you don't want it to happen?
No.
Because you love him.
I always thought I was going to marry him, yeah.
Right.
Is he aware of this, of your feelings?
I don't know if he is now, because yeah. Like, he knew, like, I used to like him, and he knew, and then...
And where are you calling from?
Illinois.
And there's only one guy in Illinois, I suspect.
What?
Yeah.
This is the only guy in Illinois?
All right. Listen. Well, listen, I know about young love. I masturbate to it almost every night. Listen, this, why has nothing ever happened between you two, when you two are such good friends? I mean, you've known the guy for a long time, right?
Yeah, it looks like he had a girlfriend, and then, like, I had a boyfriend, and then he had a girlfriend again, and then...
Right,
like,
but don't you think he's probably not into you?
Well, he was.
He was?
He was.
How do you know that?
When it was, like, the wrong time.
How do you know?
Because he told me, and it's not too hard to tell.
So you know he was into you?
Yeah.
And how into your cousin do you think he is?
Oh, he had sex with her the first day he met her.
Well that's not what
he's asking. An answer, though. Is he into her?
I didn't mean into
with his penis. I meant more
teenagers and concrete thinking.
Figuratively. Emotionally. Is he into her?
I think so. He is, but like that's bad because she's a big slut.
Okay. Yeah, but I'm sure he can figure that out. I mean, he slept with her the first day, right?
Do you listen to Loveline quite a bit?
I'm sorry?
Do you listen to Loveline quite a bit?
Yeah.
Okay, enough to understand the word boundaries, you know, when they talk about boundaries. And this is not your business. This is someone else's relationship. and it's not your business to meddle in that relationship. He knows what he wants, she knows what she wants, and you're not to be involved. So you can't always have what you want. You can't always act on your impulses. So you need to start.
And listen, why are you all of a sudden in love with this guy?
Well, I have.
She has been.
Yeah, but I know. But you've known him for how many years?
Four
years? How in love with him were you that you sat idle for 4 years, essentially? Now he's running around with your cousin and you're in love.
I'm really shy, though. Like,
listen, hold on. But that's ridiculous. You've known this guy for 4 years. Now you're deeply in love. You haven't made a move in 4 years. He hasn't done anything in 4 years. These are two people who are around each other for that many years. 4 years, by the way, when you're 17, is like 150 years to me and you.
Right.
So, was it love?
It's intimacy. And it's almost like she's an apprentice in the school of intimacy avoidance. I mean, people choose unavailable people so they can...
You should give her that guy and I'll ask his number. Hook those two up.
All right. So what is our advice for her?
Who cares?
Well, she also needs to understand the pattern she's setting up. Falling in love with people that are not available.
All right.
She's falling in love with a guy who's moving out of town. That's not even anything.
She used to go out on dates
with
three
guys
in the next month. No, we need to give her an assignment.
No, I'm not going to tell her to go out with three guys in the next month.
She needs to forget about the guy and to develop other social relationships.
All right.
Move on.
It's one of those handball against the curtain nights with you. I can feel that. I can feel
all
it.
All right, who else we got?
Valerie?
Yes.
You're 17.
Yep.
What's up?
I have this problem with, like, attracting the wrong kind of attention from guys, and it seems like every single relationship I get in, the guy's, like, a jerk.
Yeah.
And I end up getting, like, hurt and...
Yeah.
I don't know.
What kind of attention do you get from guys?
Just, like, not the right kind. Like, not what I'm looking for.
I see. All right. No, that's very specific. Thank you. Not the right kind.
Clear as mud.
There you go.
I think
that's great.
You're an example.
When you pull your car into the mechanic,
okay,
and he says, "What's wrong with the car?" You go, "Well, listen, I can't tell you what's wrong with it, but I will tell you what does work on the car." Is that how it goes?
Kinda.
I think everyone understands what she's saying.
No. You mean they just want you for sex?
Kinda, yeah.
Kinda.
Okay, this is great radio.
So,
I'm sorry, I'm kind of nervous.
So you keep hooking up with jerks?
Basically, yeah.
And are you a flirt, or is it just, you just keep...
Not necessarily. I mean, I'm really, like, outgoing and social. I don't really consider myself, like, overly flirty or anything.
What kind of role modeling did you experience in growing up with your mom and dad?
Well, when I was younger, my mom was, like, mellow, but I stopped living with her when I was 13, and I moved in with my dad, and he's kind of, like, I don't know, probably not the best role model.
Why? What did he do?
He's just very short with me. He doesn't really talk to me that much. I kind of, like, raised myself, and I have three brothers, and I raised them, too. So I was kind of, like, always the one in charge.
When did they divorce?
When I was four.
And so you were living just with your mom after that?
Yeah.
Why did you move out from your mom at 13?
My stepdad was abusive, and he was an alcoholic.
I see. And he was abusive to you?
Yeah.
What did he do to you?
He pushed me a couple times. And he was, like, verbally abusive and, like, mentally abusive. And
yeah,
it was just, like, a really big mess.
Yeah, that's out of line. I mean, Drew always says, only beat your own kids. I mean, blood-wise, never beat, only molest and beat your own kids. He always stresses that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's out of line. So, Valerie.
Yes.
You're kind of a candidate for jerks then, right?
Basically, yeah.
I mean, your dad's kind of an idiot. Your mom seems to hook up with world-class idiots.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you got your dad is sort of into his own crap and kind of aloof. Then she dumps him and marries this other guy who's beating on you.
Mm-hmm.
So you're set up for this. So your instincts are bad.
Yeah, so the next time you see a guy that you don't want anything to do with, hook up with him.
Right. That's right.
You go, yeah, I like him.
No, it's...
That's the truth.
It is.
You're going for the dildos. You gotta single out somebody who's really boring and doesn't float your boat and immediately hook up with them.
But so here's the problem.
I'm attracted to guys like that. Like, I wish I was. Like,
okay.
I know a lot of really nice guys, but they just don't like me.
Right, and that's the key here. You understand that you've had some problems with your upbringing, you've had some bad role modeling, and you understand that you're hooking up with the wrong guys. That's not enough to stop the behavior, and that's where therapy comes in. And
should I, like, not make it that big of a priority and just, like, not worry about it? Or?
No, make it make it the biggest priority in your life.
Okay.
Have you gone to counseling?
I have.
And did you internalize it? Did you really do work there, or did you just go and...
Yeah, she's a lot of totally self-actualized. What do you think?
Okay, no, she just said, Mom, maybe go. You yeah, need to I do know. It for yourself, and you need to understand that just intellectual knowledge about what's a good guy and what's not has nothing to do with being able to change what makes you make these choices. And it takes work with the therapist and your own desire to want to change. It's not easy, and it's not a superficial thing.
That's right. So back to the therapist, Valerie. And in the meantime, if you're attracted to a guy, just go the other way.
Avoid getting involved in relationships till you've dealt with this.
Don't get knocked up and don't get married.
There you go.
Sounds like a good plan. Thank you.
All right. Corey.
Hey, what's up, man?
Hey, you're 24.
Hey,
what's
Dom, what's up?
Hey, Adam, I love that man show.
Oh, well, thank you.
That man show's fabulous. Hey, can I ask a quick question first?
Sure.
I act just like you, Adam. I say, how dare you? I make porn references. I talk about getting sodomized at ATM and all that.
Beautiful.
I was going to say, this guy reminds me of you. But
yeah, that's
thank you.
Those are all great icebreakers, by the way.
Yeah, they are. And I'm running for law school president, and it's in Orange County.
Uh-huh.
And I need a theme, like a punchline or a slogan.
I see.
And, you know, everyone up there is uptight, Republican. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
I'm black, liberal. And my slogan was going to be, not just another angry black man.
Well, that's not bad.
Yeah. Really? Going back?
No, it's all right.
Yeah, you know, it doesn't have uniform.
I like Kill Whitey.
Kill Whitey, go with that one.
Kill Whitey.
Yeah, Dean's not going to allow it. I have to let something that Dean will allow.
The black one doesn't have universal appeal. You need something with
Kill Beigey?
Kill Beigey.
Kill Off Whitey?
Kill Mulatto. Hey, sure. Corey, where are you going to law school?
Pardon me?
Where are you going to law school?
Whittier Law School in Costa Mesa.
And they need a president?
Well, they need a student body president.
I see.
That's what I want to run for.
I see. And didn't Dick Nixon go there?
I think he went to the undergraduate, but, you know, we don't want to talk about Nixon. Come on.
I understand.
Black eye.
I understand. So you're proud, you're black, and you're running... You're running for president, student body
right.
president.
Mm. I figured since it was Orange County, I want something anti-black sort of, like not just another angry black man.
Right.
That'll really get the white...
How about, hey, Orange County, how did I get in here?
Right. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, how about vote for me or I'll have sex with your daughters? That might get you in.
I don't know.
Hey, your daughter? Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, that's...
There you go, Corey. All right, buddy. Hey, good luck. I hope you're the next Johnny Cochran.
Thank you.
All right, keep listening. I bet my hair's nappier than yours, even though you're black. What do you think of that?
I'm half white trash. So
I see. All right.
Yeah.
Very dangerous combination. All right, Corey. Thanks for calling in.
All right, man.
Take care of yourself. All right.
I knew right That's from the right. beginning when I heard his voice.
That he was what?
No, that he was
black?
Crazy.
How
like
dare you. Jimmy?
Yeah?
You're 14. What's up?
Nothing. I got a question for Bobcat and for you, Adam.
Well, here's Bobcat first.
All right, shoot. What's up?
How'd you get started in comedy, man?
You know, my father's the president of show business, so he said, "Son, you need
wow.
to get. You want to be a comic? You want to work craft service? What do you want to do?" I said, "I like comedy. Sounds pretty good."
Right.
Now, I started doing stand-up comedy when I was like 15 or 16, and then I got on like Letterman and stuff when I was 20. So. I don't know how I got started. I didn't, I'll tell you what to avoid. Anybody teaching a comedy course, avoid that and just try to find a stage and get on and then try to make people happy with your jokes, because that's what I try to do.
Cool.
Are you interested in getting into comedy?
Maybe.
Well, you talk to Bob's dad. What do you want to produce or direct? He can he can play. He does placement. Yeah, I mean any of those modeling. And acting and comedy, just go out and do it, essentially.
Yeah, like in your third period class, just get up to the beginning. Yeah.
That's right.
Hey, Adam?
Yes?
Who told you couldn't do those sound bites anymore?
That was our program director.
Well, you're like literally a millionaire, man. You stand up and say, I'm literally a millionaire.
That's true.
I'm literally a millionaire.
That's true. You know, the literally a millionaire thing only works with people that make less than 20 grand a year. It's not so impressive to people who make more.
Well,
you
like,
see what I'm saying?
And I'm not like those girls that called in about you, but I do have your name on my notebook.
Thank you. I'd like to see it on your shoe, too, if that's okay.
All
Could
right,
you do
and,
that? Thank you. All right. Hey, Jimmy?
Yeah.
All right. Good luck with the comedy career.
Yeah, hold on a second. My friends and I are looking to open up a Seattle chapter of the Jackers. You're talking about that a while ago.
Jesus Christ. All right. Thank you.
You're really helping mold some minds.
I know. Yeah.
What's that about?
When people regurgitate things that you've said at earlier times on the air back to you, it's always that much more uncomfortable.
It's like security.
Watching a videotape of you drunk at a party. You know what I'm talking about? It's always embarrassing. Like, oh, yeah, when I was using, yeah, I knew I was bad. Lena?
Lena.
Lena?
Yes.
You're 17. What's up?
Well, Adam, I love you.
Great, thank you.
And Bobcat?
Yeah.
You're fine.
Oh, all right. I thought I was getting ready for the slam.
Here comes.
Adam, I love you. Bobcat, are you sick?
Yeah.
No, you're pretty hot. Sexy voice, too.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
How old do you think Bobcat is?
36.
Ooh, son of a bitch. We haven't played Guess Bobcat's age in a while, but
doesn't he have a kid that's 36?
He was.
Oh, Bruce, easy. Oh, I'm trying to go so nice on you.
He was on the Tonight Show while Jack Parr was hosting.
Jack Benny?
Do you have a question or what?
Well, yeah, I have two questions. I saw my mom, my mom and my dad are still married. Last night, I saw my mom having sex with another guy.
How did you figure that one out?
I walked in and I realized it wasn't my dad. I looked out and his truck wasn't here, so I was like, what? And about maybe in September, I saw my dad with another woman. I kind of followed him. And I wanted to know.
Where did you follow him? Where did you see him?
Oh, he said he was going to work. He's a lawyer. And so I followed him. And he was with another woman.
Wait a minute. Why did you follow him when he says he goes to work every day? Do you follow him every day?
No, I just follow him that time. Like, I heard his conversation over the phone. And
so you followed him out of the house down, you got in your car and followed him in his car?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I used one of my friends because he would know that it's me.
Smart.
So.
All right, so you followed him, and where'd he go?
He went to one of the hotels out here.
I see. And he met a woman there?
Yeah, and she was all up on his jock, and I'm like, what? So, like,
she was all up on
his jock? All up in his junk.
Jock. Oh.
His jock.
What would you do, drive into the motel room and stake it out?
No, it wasn't like your mom dressed in a costume or something.
Yeah.
This isn't something they do.
Couples do that when they get bored.
Now, do your parents act like a couple? Do they act like they like each other?
No.
Okay.
All right, so wait a minute. You followed your dad. He pulls into a motel. He meets a woman, and then they walk into one of the rooms.
Yes.
All right, so that's the last you saw that.
Yeah.
So you can assume something went on there.
Yeah.
And then the other day, you come home, and your mom is underneath another guy.
Last night.
Yeah.
Thanks. And,
That really clarifies it, Bruce.
That's a totally different situation. So, she had the door open in her bedroom, or how did you see this?
Well, I came home early and from work, and I walked in. And I saw this guy on top of her. I'm like, what? It's not my dad. And I'm just like, oh, my God. They didn't even bother to lock the door.
Yeah. It's weird that you're like going, hey, that's not my dad. I my first thing would be like, whoa, I don't want to see this, period.
Yeah. Even if it is. Yeah.
I wouldn't care if it was Pop or specifically.
Okay, so we can assume you've got a very chaotic life going
on.
It
kind of scares
right
me that you recognized a stranger's ass right off the bat. Hey, that's not Pop's ass.
How long have they not been getting along?
Probably for the past 4 years, maybe.
And prior to that, things were pretty good? Good relationship with
Lena? Oh, well, who cares? Listen, Lena.
Yeah.
You're almost out of the house, right? You're 17?
Mm-hmm.
You're going off to college somewhere?
Yes, I am.
Okay. When are you going off to college?
After graduation.
I see. Let me grab a scratch pad. You're going to graduate first?
Yes.
Yeah, I see. Okay. It's fascinating. Very interesting way to do it.
Are there other kids in your family?
Yeah, there's three of us.
Yeah, so it sounds like they got a beard marriage going on. It sounds like their marriage is over and they're trying to,
keep
it together for the kids.
How old do you have, younger?
Yeah, I have a younger one. He's about 16 and the other one's 21.
Good. Screw them. You go off to college and start your own life.
Oh, that's great advice.
Yeah.
No, listen,
they're old enough.
I mean,
part
of the reason it's significant, it was just last night, is because things like this are really painful and they're very difficult to see.
Yeah,
it's bad enough if you walk in on your parents with each other having sex, but much less, the boyfriend.
The plumber.
How upset are you? I mean, is this something where you...
I'm not upset. It really hurts me.
Right.
Like, I'm really hurt.
How about...
Hey, did your mother say anything to you? Did your mother say, boy...
She didn't know that I saw her.
Oh, she didn't go. Isn't that weird that my friend and I were wrestling and you came in?
Why don't you confront your mom and give her a chance to make you feel better? Mm-hmm. Because otherwise it's going to freak out. You're going to be really mean to your mom and she's not going to know what's going on. Then she's going to get angry with you and it's going to snowball, all right?
Alrighty. Well, the other thing is do you have any stability, any stable adults that you can talk to? Do you go to church? Do you have a school counselor?
Yes, I do.
Which one?
Both.
Okay. You've got to talk to somebody because a lot of feelings are going to come up, not just the next day, but a month from now or 2 months from now, that are difficult to understand and deal with. And you need somebody to help you sort through things.
Okay.
It should be your parents that are setting a good example and providing somebody to talk to.
Beautiful.
So you need to talk to somebody tomorrow. Okay.
Don't get married. Don't get pregnant.
Don't worry.
Go far, far away to college and talk to your mom about this.
Okay.
Maybe she's got a good excuse.
No.
Maybe it was her gynecologist.
I talked to somebody else before I talked to my mom about it, because it sounds like...
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
You need to
stop her mom.
Maybe her mom's a counselor.
Yeah, maybe her mom will explain that it was just a friend or something.
Yeah.
What's she going to say? I mean,
well, it was the plumber came by. She didn't have any cash. You know.
Yeah.
She could tell her something that might make it all right.
Make her feel better.
Yeah. We'll take a break. We'll be back.
Then I'll explain things.
Shut up.
Loveline, we'll be right back.
That is Dr. Bruce over there. You know him as Dr. Spaz. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Here we go now, Bruce. Here we go, buddy.
What's that?
We're going now.
That hat bothers me.
We're going.
Why'd you put the hat on?
Bruce?
Part of the comedy.
Bruce?
Right?
Let's not do any
I just noticed
weird or bad radio.
Yeah, let's not talk about visual crap right now.
There we go.
Hey, this is me, Bob Cat Goldthwait, and where am I? I'm at the Irvine Improv this weekend.
That's
so,
right.
Yeah. And, yeah.
Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And
I was looking out a window one day, and I said, how did I become Bobcat? Like, I got really grossed out. It's not a funny story, but it just hit me. I was like...
Well, you know what I was thinking about, like yesterday, was you at the MTV Movie Awards when you came out in that Prince outfit with your guts
my gut hanging out, yeah.
And all that. And I thought that people who haven't seen Bobcat in a little while would be shocked to see the transformation. First, everyone thought he was on drugs.
Yeah.
But now that we're used to it, it's good.
Well,
really
yeah.
Good. Yeah.
Well, you know, whatever. I lost a lot of weight.
How much weight did you lose?
Like about 50, 60 pounds.
What were you at your peak?
220. But, yeah. You know, so many negative things are said about heroin. No one ever talks about the positive aspects.
They don't talk about the good.
No, they never do. You know, I'm, whatever. No, 220. I'm not
the good news about Bobcat in 220s, you know, on that 5'8 frame, he could really spread it out. You know, it had a big frame.
5'7.
You can always say you had to gain the weight for a movie role.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Hey, I got a job. I have a small part in a real movie coming up.
Oh, really? What is it?
It's called Blow, is the movie.
Is it playing with Snatch?
Yeah. It probably will, blowing Snatch.
Who's in it?
It's Johnny Depp.
Wow.
It's about coke. It's not porno.
Oh, good. So they want to...
Although, you know what? Johnny Depp's a good-looking guy. You know what I mean? If I was going to make the leap, that's a good place to start.
You could do worse. You could do me or Jimmy.
What? And what are you talking about?
I mean,
I got the job. What are you talking about?
Again. All right. When is that out, by the way?
It's out in a couple months.
So you just did the part.
I did the part a while ago. I'm in the trailer, I guess. I haven't...
Really?
Yeah, my friends are telling me they see me in the trailer a lot.
Well, we'll keep an eye
out for that. You're exemplifying good radio for me.
Okay, hold on
what?
Now.
Johnny
Bruce,
Depp.
Hold on, I gotta yell at Bruce. Bruce, we got a guest on the show.
Okay.
Right? The guest was in a movie with Johnny Depp that's coming out soon.
Okay.
So we're talking about that.
Okay.
All right.
I started like obsessing on how good looking Johnny Depp is. And then
he really is hot.
And he's a nice guy. And then eventually I'm like looking at him, like trying to look for a flaw. And he had some like blotch on his arm. And I'm thinking, and then like he's a nice guy, but I'm going, oh, you're Johnny Depp, you know. In my head, I'm going, between my wrist and elbow, I am so hotter than you.
Yeah.
I am so. It was Paul Rubens, me, and Johnny Depp in the same scene. It was like the community service players. I actually said that one when I look. I go, is anybody in this scene not on probation?
How much community service did you get for setting the Tonight Show set on fire?
All I had to do, I was on probation for about 4 years, and then I had to do PSAs.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, and
do you
yeah.
have some of those?
No, but we can get them. But like yeah. in my nightclub act, I'll go, hey, I'm Bobcat Goldthwait. Whatever you do, don't set a talk show on fire. Back to you, McGruff. And here's Kelsey Grammer with some safe driving tips. And I was like, what did Rosie O'Donnell and Penny Marshall do to Kmart that they had to work off? Okay, that's my nightclub act, right? But in reality, the commercials were like, I had to do this, like, they made me keep redoing them. Like, the Burbank fire marshal didn't like, he questioned my performance, my sincerity. Because right. I had to go like this, and this is really embarrassing. I had to go like this. I go, hi, I'm Bobcat Goldthwait. You know, I can switch back and forth. That was it. But if you're seriously injured in a fire, yeah.
You can't go back.
Yeah, you can't go back. So I only know one person that ever saw him air, yeah.
So Bob, well, it's because they run at 4:30 in the morning on weekends. But the fire marshal for the Burbank, city of Burbank said, like, okay, Bob, that was good, but let's try it again.
He says, you know what? You're giving me a 7, and I need a 10. You know.
This time, listen. I want you to have fun with it. We know it's a PSA.
I'm sure I'm sarcastic. I'm sure like, if you're seriously injured in a fire.
Denise?
Hello, Denise.
Hi.
You're 17. What's up?
All right. I'm going out with a 22-year-old guy.
Mm-hmm.
My parents are okay with it. If they weren't okay with it, then...
I think it's disgusting.
Shut up.
I think age differences are terrible.
Yeah.
All right. Well, go on, Denise.
Bob's dating a zygote right now.
So, I mean, we talked, like, all week, and we really get along well. It was hard for me before to find any guy, because high school guys are just really gross, and it's really hard to, you know, get a good conversation going with them. And with Ryan, it's just really nice.
Sure, that's right.
What does Ryan do?
Well, he's still in college.
I see. Junior college?
No, like, college.
Ooh. So, what college does he go to?
CSUN.
Yeah, that's barely a college. Yes, the Santa Monica Junior College makes fun of CSUN, by the way. But anyway, he's 22, and you can talk to him because you're 17 and you're more mature than most of the guys.
Yeah.
All right, and your parents are okay with it.
Yeah, they're fine with it. If they weren't fine with it, then most likely I wouldn't go out with him.
Well, what's your problem then? What's your question?
Is it really that wrong? I mean...
Is he a good guy?
Yeah, he's a good guy. He completely respects me.
Do you have sex with him?
God, no.
No?
Not yet. I mean...
How long have you been going out?
Girl.
How long have you been going with him?
About like a week or so. But we've been talking like every single day.
We
talk like every single day for like hours.
Here's the issue. It's normal for teenage girls to be more mature than guys. And so it's not unusual to find them very unattractive and unappealing. The problem... when you get to somebody that's that much older, you are going to change immensely over the next several years. And if you get locked into a relationship, if you get physically involved with him, then I'm telling her why it's a problem.
All right, but she's in love with the guy. He's in college. She's a senior. Parents don't mind. Just take it slow. We're not going to talk her out of it.
Does he care about you?
Yeah, he really does.
Does he buy you beer?
Well, not beer. I mean, I wouldn't drink it. Illegal.
They got a good system. She buys the tickets when they go to the movies, and then after the movies, he scores the Mickey's Big Mouth, and they go over to his folks' place.
Right. Nobody's going to be able to talk you out of it, but it's good that you're asking the question, and the answer is it's not a healthy situation to be in, and maintaining the relationship is...
I'm all right with this one. All right.
So it's really okay?
No.
Yes.
What the...
Listen, it's not a big age difference.
You need to dump him for a 40-year-old.
Any counselor that you talk to is going to discourage you from getting heavily involved.
Take it slow. Do not engage in any form of sodomy for a couple of weeks, and just take it slow.
Great.
There you go. Buck?
Yeah, hey, Adam, you're the king.
Thank you. Are you drunk?
Not yet.
Okay.
How you doing?
Good, Buck. What's up?
Nothing. Bobcat, you're cool.
Oh, well, thanks. That ought to keep the shotgun out of my mouth later on this evening.
Yeah, put it in your ear.
Thanks. I'll be like going, Buck thinks I'm cool.
Buck, how old do you think Bobcat is?
38.
Oh, all right, Buck.
What's going on?
Now, Buck, you sound like a smart guy. Now, what's your question?
My question is, I just made up my question tonight so I could talk with you guys.
Well, what was your makeup question, Buck?
That my wife was with three guys and I came home and saw them.
Oh, and it was only two?
No, it was four.
All right. Buck, did you want to talk to us, though, or did you just want to kind of goof off?
I wanted to get Bobcat and you guys, I want to get on the man show, Adam.
Okay.
You need me on the man show.
Well, I understand. What do you do besides lie?
I make up good funnies. I'm good looking.
Oh, I see. Yeah, we need more attractive men on the man show. We already have Jimmy Kimmel, one of the best looking men in the United States on the show.
All right. I'll be all right.
What are funnies? Are funnies like zingers?
Yeah, give us an example of a good bit you could contribute to the man show.
A good bit I could.
Yeah.
Oh. Geez, you put me on the line here, Adam.
Well, wait a minute. Who called who and said they had a bunch of funnies for the man show?
But I didn't come up for auditions for the man show yet.
All right,
Buck. Listen, I'm hanging up on
we you. Need more guys like you in that office pronto.
What's up?
We need more guys like you over at the man show.
Yeah.
Guys are going, I didn't come up with the jokes yet.
Can he fart on demand or anything like that with his body parts?
First off,
you know, that's not what the show's
about.
Yeah,
it's not.
The guy doesn't sound like he has a lot to
it do. Is about farting, but it's so much more. There's farting, and then there's number one, and then there's masturbation, and then we're back to farting again. Timothy?
Yeah.
You're 13?
Mm-hmm.
What's up?
I shaved my pubic hairs because they were, like, coming up the side of my penis, and now there's, like, itching down there, and I can't get it stopped. I've conditioned it and used itch cream.
Use itch cream?
What's itch cream?
What is that?
Like, it comes in like lip balm type thing, but it's not really like that, and you just rub it on the skin around there.
Itch cream? And now in lip balm container?
Ah, maybe it's like Vicks Vapor Rub he's putting down there.
How long ago did you shave? When did you shave?
2 weeks ago or so.
Now, you know, it's only going to come back like crazy.
That's right.
Do you have are there a lot of red areas where the hairs come out of the skin?
No.
Okay, did you try just a white powder, a talc-type powder, shower powder?
It's going to grow back in, and then it won't be a big deal.
Right.
Yeah, you'll be fine. Meanwhile, people think you have crabs. That's cool, because when you're 13, you know, it suggests you've been with a woman. I used to walk around scratching my groin needlessly just so, you know, the word was put out that I was with somebody.
Yeah, Benadryl cream.
I
don't know what kind
of crotch.
Well,
the ladies like a guy scratching his crotch.
I
think he's got the crabs. Pshaw, I think it's gonorrhea.
That's right.
Get in line.
Fight would break out. Yeah. Timothy?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're fine. Just
Timothy,
let it grow
you're 13
back.
Years old. What are you doing with a sharp object down there around, you know,
wasn't really sharp. It was like a beard and mustache trimmer.
I don't know, but, you know, I never even got my man fro till I was, like, about 18, 19.
Yeah.
Is anybody else seeing your crotch that you need this thing to clean it up?
Not really.
And whose beard and mustache trimmer? Is it your dad's?
No.
It's yours.
Oh, that's good.
You own your own.
Mm-hmm.
And what's it for?
I don't know.
Is that what someone gave you this for Christmas? And you're going, I got nothing to cut yet.
I got the Don Johnson beard kit, and he's 13 years old. All right, we will take ourselves another break. When we come back, we'll speak to Rachel. She's 23, is a stripper, and has been in many threesomes. Thinks it's normal. Hold on a second. Rachel?
Yeah.
How many threesomes have you been in?
I don't know, like five, six.
Five or six. All right, girl. Two guys and you, and two girls and you? Or?
Two guys and me, girls and me,
right.
Guy and girl and me.
I see. Good times. Hold on a second.
Okay.
All right. We'll get back with Rachel and her threesomes, Dr. Bruce and Bobcat after this.
Oh, yeah. Everybody now.
Yes, I will be right back in a minute.
LoveLine will be right back.
It's the LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. Bobcat Goldthwait is our guest tonight. He'll be at the Irvine Improv next weekend, or this coming weekend, yeah, Friday, Saturday, Sunday?
And Sunday, yeah. A special show for the kids.
That's right. Sunday matinees.
Uh-huh. I'll be doing balloon animals. Looking forward to that.
So, and also, Bob is touring the country, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Check your local listings. I'm sure I'm at some chain quality comedy club. But more importantly, the reason why a lot of horny dudes are driving around the block is to get back to this call.
Rachel. Rachel?
Hi, Adam.
All right. So Rachel's 23. She's a stripper. Mm-hmm. Topless and bottomless?
Mm-hmm. All right. It's a totally new gentleman's club.
I see. Where, you're calling from Cincinnati?
Mm-hmm.
Do they serve alcohol?
It's a private bottle club. They don't serve it, but you bring it in and drink it. They serve it back to you, basically.
Right. You bring in beer and they, like, sell you a cup.
Whatever you bring in, they sell right back to you.
Now, you clear that up. I don't understand the getting liquored up and seeing a vagina at the same time, why that would make you go nuts, why they have to have all these screwy laws.
They do out here in California, but I don't think they have them in the rest of the country. Or they have some form of it, like this one. You bring in your own booze and they sell it back to you.
I went to a bachelor party in Dayton, Ohio, and they wouldn't allow any drinking where it was bottomless.
Yeah.
Well, in the state of Ohio, you're not supposed to have alcohol and nudity under the same roof.
Exactly.
All right. So how does it?
How about like if you're married?
How does it work? How does it work that they bring the booze in and then it's sold back to them?
Well, they don't get as drunk that way.
No. How does it work? Would you shut up? How does it work?
You bring in like a 12-pack of beer and take it to the bar. The barmaid basically you have a private membership, and under your membership number. The bartender puts your membership number in the computer with what kind of beer you bring in, and basically she'll sell it back to you for $2.50 a beer. And
I see.
Yeah, they have that in Utah too, a corkage fee. I think.
Probably sell some money. It's funny. There's something called corkage going on in a strip club, but anyway.
Well, a lot of people think it's really dumb. I don't understand it myself. I think it actually is cheaper though, because like before we lost our liquor license, it was like $4 a beer and
easily.
You know,
yeah,
two beers, there's your 6-pack. So
right. How'd they lose their liquor license?
Serving alcohol after hours. It's a club that's right next to the new Hustler thing.
I see. All right.
But, well, you know, anyway. Whatever.
So you've had many threesomes.
Right.
And do you have a boyfriend?
Yeah.
And is he engaged in all these threesomes?
Yeah. Well, some of them. He knows about all of them.
I see.
He's been in all but maybe two of them.
I see. And what were the two that he wasn't included
with
in?
With other women.
I see. He's all right with that.
Right.
And you're saying it's healthy, it's a normal sexual expression.
Well, I'm not really saying that. I just kind of, like last week, some guy called you and Dr. Drew and said, you know, his wife went off and had this threesome without him or whatever, and you guys went back to, well, you know, did her dad rape her? You know, you guys always go back to these theories about...
Right, but it turned out her dad did rape her, right?
Right, but now what if, you know...
You're wondering why you do this?
Right. Well, I mean, it's not why I do this, but what's your theory on people who do these things? That,
well, they're usually a little chaotic.
Never been a fantasy of mine.
I think I am. I'm perfectly sane. I'm totally normal, you know?
Right, but...
Well, you're calling the show. If you don't have a problem, you wouldn't be calling.
But you work at a nudie place, and you got some boyfriend who's trying to start a band or something, and, you know, what's your boyfriend?
What's the name of his band?
He don't have a band. Actually, he
don't have a band.
He's working now for a local...
You put the bird on the phone.
A local chemical company. They go and clean up chemical spills around the world.
I see. All
totally
right. So he has a good job.
Yeah.
All right. And your family is normal?
My family is normal. I went to college. You know, granted, it was a junior college. You have a theory on that, too.
Oh, yes, I do.
But after college, I went to work for a good health insurance company, for Blue Cross and Blue Shield. I got laid off from that job, got hard up for money, started stripping. That was like 4 years ago. Money's addictive, you know what I mean, to stripping. I make really good money stripping.
How much money do you make on an average night?
On an average night, I can make like $600.
And that's
working 6 hours.
And that's all cash, right?
That's all cash.
Yep, I'd do it. If my ass wasn't so hairy, I'd get into it.
But Rachel, there are certain things that are commonly accepted as being normal or healthy, and then other things that are not. And if you have a fundamental disagreement with that, which sounds like what you're at issue with, then it's difficult to prove anything or discuss it. But if you go to a therapist, they'll talk to you about boundaries. They'll ask you about your upbringing. And I think a lot of people in your industry have had abuse issues or a lot of chaos growing up in the home.
You talking about health care or stripping?
Stripping.
I see.
And the Blue Cross.
Blue Cross people. Hey, Rachel?
Yeah.
Listen, we got to go to another call. But here's the situation. Fine. knock yourself out. God bless you. But when you settle down and you have kids and you get married, you should probably quit.
Well, yeah, I don't plan on doing it forever, but...
Okay.
But you have no theory on people who do these things? Like,
oh, they usually a little, some chaos in the background. But you're not one of those people. It's most people. It's not all people.
But the issue is if you're trying to achieve intimacy in a relationship, it just sabotages that, and it's almost 100% failure for the relationship when you start acting out in this way. It just doesn't...
Has your boyfriend been with you with another guy, too?
Yeah.
That doesn't bother him?
No.
What's he do with the guy?
He doesn't do anything with the guy.
But still, there's got to be some junk brushage going on, doesn't there?
I don't know. I don't really pay attention.
All right, Rachel.
Hey, dude, that's mine.
Rachel, you know you're screwed up, though, right?
See, I don't think I am.
She doesn't think so.
Honestly,
well,
I don't.
Just the fact that you have a bird is enough.
What's the bird's name?
Dean.
Hey, Dean, it's a shout-out going to you.
Right.
Dean.
It's just
humans must die.
It's difficult.
Humans must die.
Working out a relationship between two people when you start throwing other people into the mix.
A threesome is like, hey, how can I wake up with two disappointed ladies? Not a big fantasy of mine.
All right, we're going to take a break. Listen, if it works for her and she's young and what the hell, then go ahead and do it.
It doesn't work for her, though, and the problem is she's calling at one point when she thinks it does.
See?
So it doesn't work for anybody.
All right, there
And it's
you
the
go.
Fastest way to...
All right, Bruce. Blah, blah, blah. All right, Buzzkill.
The Bible's calling you. Go get to it. We're going to take ourselves a little break. Bobcat Goldthwait is here. Dr. Bruce is here, and we'll be back with Vic, who has a major problem after this.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191. Wow, you know this
thing about how you know you can. We'll be right back.
LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Bruce. Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew tonight. He's a board-certified addiction medicine specialist that does tattoo removal. Addiction medicine specialist. He is probably smarter, I dare say, than Drew, or at least has studied more.
Where's the punchline?
Probably know more about medicine than Drew,
really?
Right?
Like, yeah. If you were sick, you'd go to Bruce and not Drew?
I think I would. I would.
Like, if I was feeling... ill and I had a misspelled tattoo, Bruce, right away.
Bruce is the
guy. Here's the thing. Drew wouldn't see him because his boundaries are very, very clear in terms of treating friends, and he figures that mine aren't as healthy, so he
really?
Comes to me.
That's, I've asked Drew, like, medical problems. I had some ass problem a few years
back. He would not
see
you. He would not
He didn't see me, but he told me what to do with my ass problems.
Go see another doctor.
He told me what to do with my ass problem, too, and which was nothing.
Where is that? Where is Drew tonight?
He's somebody dropped a quarter in Dayton, and he's gone over there to pick it up. I have no idea where he is.
He's picked that quarter up the last five times I've been here. You gotta
Hello! Hello, caller!
Vic?
Hey, what up, Adam? How you doing?
Good, you're 19. What's up?
Yeah, I'm 19, that's correct. I'm from Detroit, represent what. Bobcat, you're funny, but I'm funnier. Adam, you're cool.
But you're cooler? Right.
All right.
I got myself in a little dilemma about two and a half weeks ago. This girl calls me up. Her name's Julie. She lives about three blocks away from me.
Is she bling bling?
Yeah. And she's like, come over, da da da. You know, my dad just left, blah blah blah, the whole spiel. So I come over the crib. We're doing our thing in her room, blah blah blah. And next thing I know, I don't even really remember what happened because I was like on top of her. We were under the covers. And all I know is I look up, the blanket's pulled off me, and there's a gun pointed at me. It's her father. So I'm thinking, oh, great, you know, I'm like, so I get up, I jump up, and I'm, you know, I'm completely naked, I get up, I throw my boxers on, he's like yelling at his daughter, da-da-da, you know, flipping out, like, I'm talking, like, going crazy. So I'm like, I'm not going to stick around for this, so as I'm, like, running out the door, I get shot in my leg. So it didn't, like, it hurt, but, like, it was, like, pure adrenaline, I'm running, I'm limping, I'm just trying to get the hell out of there, you know. I'm like in the living room.
God, I hate that when you get shot.
Yeah, you know, just another day in the hood, though, you know.
He and, shot you in the leg because you were on top of his daughter. How old is his daughter?
She's 18, I think.
And how old is her dad?
He looked around.
No, I don't give a rat's ass.
All right. So are you sure she's of age?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, I grew up with a girl. She lives about 6 houses away from me.
All right. So she's an adult.
Yeah.
Okay. And you had sex with her. You got shot in the leg.
Yeah.
And what was your next move?
My next move was I'll bounce to the crib. I'm hopping down the sidewalk. Like, I made a big scene. The neighbors, because the guy came out shooting. He shot the gun in the air a couple more times. Don't ever come back to my house again. I'll kill you, stupid head. He started, like, you know, he went
stupid
out.
Stupid head?
Well, if he's going to start pulling out the... I mean, getting shot is one thing, but when being called stupid head.
The line has been drawn in the sand. Listen, are you able to get a boner anymore? Because with that kind of Pavlovic stimuli, you know, every time I thought about getting a hard-on, I'm thinking about getting shot in the leg. I don't know if it'd work.
No, that's actually later on in my question, but I'm just giving you guys the basic outline of what happened.
I see. Did you go to the hospital?
Yeah, so what happened was EMS got called. I went to the hospital. I was in the hospital for about a week and a half because I lost a lot of blood and that whole thing. And my main question was this. When I'm lying in bed, I get up real quick. Like, this has just happened as, you know, you said, Vic, you're on the phone. I went to get up, and I get real lightheaded. I got to sit back down.
I see.
And so that's not even a big thing.
Wait, how long ago did this happen?
About a week and a half ago. I was in the hospital for about a week and a half. I just got out today, so.
Okay, so you're just out of the hospital. Yeah. What happened to this guy? Did the cop show up?
Well, I'm assuming he's in jail, hopefully. I mean, the Detroit police showed up, everything. He got taken away.
Well, then you better get right back over to that house.
Yeah, before he gets
get right in there.
Yeah, but, yeah, there's some.
You got to get back on the bike. You got thrown off, young man.
There's some drama in the neighborhood right now, but I mean, whatever. It's nothing I can't work out myself.
Yeah,
but,
it's none of those beeswax.
Another problem I have is, like, so when I get up, but I realized I just took a joint to the head, you know? And but when I smoke a J, it just, like, no big deal. Like, I don't get lightheaded. But the only thing they gave me is a whole bunch. I'm on Vicodin, too. So, like, this joint just really hit good with the Vicodins, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, what I'll do is crush up the Vicodin and put it in the joint.
Mm. Oh, no, I never tried that.
Yeah, that's a little comedy here.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's your question?
Well, he wants to know why he's lightheaded.
Yeah, like, and then
you're on. You got a slug in your thigh. You got a Vicodin and a joint in you.
And you're all hopped up on the pot.
I'm just chilling, you know.
Okay, there's something called postural hypotension, which is the most likely thing when you get up quickly and your blood supply it pools out, and especially after you've had an injury like that, you lost a lot of blood, you're still going to be having a little problem with your blood volume.
Yeah.
So, and then secondly, taking the Vicodin for some people, you know, the first thing you ask somebody
the
when
thing
they...
The that bothers me about the whole thing is I couldn't even bust my nut, you know? But
yeah,
I went to the hospital with blue ball.
Okay, well, I can't solve that
now
problem.
Now, that's the biggest tragedy, the whole story, is that you couldn't bust your nut.
I couldn't even get my nut on, you know, but...
Right, so the most common thing with most people is medication.
Now, who says chivalry's dead, by the way? Go ahead, Bruce.
Blood loss. No, I'm done. I think we...
All right, so...
Postural hypotension.
He should just relax for a little while longer.
Sounds like he needs to chill in the crib without the Vicodin and pot. And
right.
Get up a little more slowly.
And keep practicing that safe sex.
Yeah, I smell great things in the future for Vic. I really do.
He's one of your big fans, though.
We'll be reading about him in Forbes in a few short months. Chill?
Yes.
You're 26.
I am.
What's up?
This is embarrassing. I'm married, been married for a couple of years,
mm-hmm.
And my husband has to be away now for work, and he's been away for a couple of months.
What's he do?
He's in the military.
I see. And he shipped off somewhere?
Yeah.
All right. And he won't be back for a little while?
Yeah.
All right.
Not for another, like, 6 months.
I see.
And I've been having these type of dreams that I've never had before. And I've heard that, well, of course, everyone knows, you know, guys and their wet dreams or whatever, but can women do that, too? Because I think that's what I've been doing.
Yes, they can. You've been having orgasm in your sleep, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you can do that. You can probably do it easier than a guy can.
Well, how come it's never happened before? I'd be doing a lot more sleeping.
Well, I mean...
Your husband's away not having sex, right?
Right.
Okay, so
that's one reason. Yeah, you got a little congestion built up down there. Number two, sometimes women hit their sexual prime a little bit later. You know, you may not have been as into it at 17 as you are now at 26.
I see.
You know what I mean? You've changed. You've evolved.
Well, why couldn't I have evolved while he was still home?
Wow, is this something you really want? Like every time you take a nap, like, oh! You know?
Well, no, but if it was that easy to have an orgasm, it would have been nice to have my husband here.
I would be jealous of your dreams. I go, wake up. Wake up.
Because there are no technique issues in your dreams either. I mean, it's just a pure response to
the
thought.
Wait a minute. Are you unable to have an orgasm with your husband?
It's difficult.
Not with him out of town, I guess.
Yeah, it's been difficult, but not only with my husband. It's been difficult throughout my sexual life.
Right, and that includes your brother and your uncle and everyone else, right?
Oh, yeah, sure.
And now, does your husband give you oral sex?
He tries to, but I don't like it.
Why not?
It makes me uncomfortable.
Why?
I don't know. It just does.
Well, has anything ever happened to you?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, did anyone ever make you feel uncomfortable before?
Yeah.
Who was that?
Oh, it was a long time ago when I was a kid.
Oh, I see. Who was that?
It was like some old babysitter.
Who did what to you?
Just made me feel uncomfortable.
I see.
Were you molested or were you just... Okay.
All right, by the babysitter.
Yeah.
All right, well, that's probably one of the reasons you're having a little difficulty. So you're having trouble relaxing, being intimate with your husband, but when you're asleep, your mind tends to relax and it runs wild, and then you have your orgasm.
Okay.
And your conscious mind's not getting in the way.
So how about getting a little therapy for the molestation episode that happened when you were younger?
I have. I've had lots of therapy.
Yeah?
But also another thing that is bothering me about the dreams is my husband's not in the dreams.
I see.
And there's even been a woman in the dreams.
Yeah.
Who I don't know, but...
Estelle Getty?
Pardon?
Estelle Getty?
No.
One of the Golden Girls?
Who's in the dream? I'll tell you if you should be weird. Is it someone you know?
Well, someone from TV.
Who is it from TV?
Bobcat?
Oh my gosh.
Is it someone from TV?
Be real careful.
Monica from Friends.
Well, that's not a bad choice.
Yeah, I've gotten a few off there.
Why am I dreaming about a woman?
I don't know. I feel the way about Screech, you know, Desmond Diamond. I wake up with a raging heart on when I think about Saved by the Bell.
Oh, no.
Hey, Jill, listen, the reason your husband is not in the dreams is because, A, what do you need him for? You got him in reality.
Right.
So why dream about him? Number two, you don't equate him with an orgasm, so he'd only get in the way.
Is that Goofy Arquette guy in there?
No.
David Arquette's not involved with the dreams?
No, but Chandler is.
Chandler?
Oh, really?
Wow. So you're just pulling a train with the Friends. Like the real good Friends.
No,
but is it every night? Is it
Chandler
the...
is not in the dreams. I was joking.
Oh, all right. Well, I'm a comic. I don't...
It can be funny.
I know. I'm a comic. I don't like sarcasm or irony, and I never get jokes. Listen, is it only the Friends program? Or, you know what I mean?
No, that's just... I answered too many questions.
All right.
Listen, don't freak out. Most women have these fantasies. It doesn't mean you're going lesbian.
And if you switch over to Nash Bridges, then you got problems.
Yeah, then call us.
Yeah, like, oh my God, Cheech Marin. Oh.
I mean, dreams are an outlet for outrageous thoughts you might have and fantasy. And as long as you don't start worrying about the comparison to your...
What was that, Bruce?
You don't worry about what's going on with your husband. You're not as sexually responsive.
Use complete words, or we're going to get the FCC down here pretty fast.
As long as you don't worry about that, then don't compare it to your normal life and don't worry about outrageous dreams.
And a little more therapy and see if you can relax a little with your husband so you can have the orgasm. Lucy, God knows what he's doing in Manila right now. Lucy, you're 18.
Yeah.
What's up?
Well, I was calling because I've been going out with this guy for a few months. And we're like really, really close. But okay, this is kind of interesting. I'm bisexual, and I kind of have the idea of bringing a woman sort of into our relationship, not really, just kind of for fun. But the issue is not like how to bring it up with him, because we've talked about it before. The issue is kind of how to bring it up to her.
Well, who's her?
Okay, she's this girl who I've known for a really long time, and
Monica from Friends?
No. No, she's not, but she's this girl, like, we've been friends for a really long time, and before I got together with my boyfriend, she and I, we have had sex before.
Yeah.
And we're just really close, and...
Well, is she like your boyfriend?
Yeah.
She does.
They get along really well.
Okay. Well, how do you think they get along if they were naked in the same bed?
Well, see, the thing is like, it's not, it's really difficult to explain because, she has had, like, a lot of difficulties with just, like, feeling like she's cared for romantically, and, like, I really care about her, and, like, my boyfriend's okay with us sort of, like, I don't know, with both of us being really caring towards her. Like, it's not so much about, like, the fact that I really want to have sex with this girl. It's more about how, like, I want to show her that people can be caring and stuff because she had a really big, like...
All right, but do you have to go down on her in order to prove that to her?
Well, she liked it last time, but...
I see. So no. in order to show that you're caring for her, you have to go down on her while your boyfriend just sort of strokes it in the corner?
No, it's not like that, really.
Well, okay, listen, screwball. You're very chaotic. And what you're looking for here is to probably screw with this relationship. Okay. You know what I mean? I mean, you got a relationship with a guy, everything's fine, and now you have to take in this sort of bisexual friend of yours and show her that you care for her.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a weird instinct. It's going to undo the relationship.
Okay.
Aren't you afraid of losing her or him, your boyfriend?
Yeah, kind of.
Well, then you shouldn't do it.
Kind of, but not really.
I think maybe you're just bored.
No. It's not quite like that. It's just...
No, you're not going, I think I need to help my friend. I like the fact that your boyfriend was such a pillar, and he said, you know what, honey, I'm willing.
Yeah.
You know, I'll throw it to her.
You know, I knew you guys were going to say that, actually.
That's right. He's such a philanthropist.
He's such a giver.
I'll get the wine cooler.
How long did he slave over this decision? Was he like, oh, I don't know what to do.
Bobcat, congratulations on everyone thinking that you're, like, mid to late 30s.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, because I used to watch your really creepy show.
What are you getting mad at me? You come up with some goofball question about asking us permission to go bang your friend, and you're getting all mad at me.
I'm not mad at you. I just think it's cool.
Well,
was kind of creepy.
How old do you think he is?
Oh, God, let's see. I think I know this. You're, like 52?
Yeah, that's right.
There you go.
No, actually, I'm 65.
Right. So he looks good for his age.
Yeah.
Okay, so Lucy, it sounds like you consider this a therapeutic opportunity. But you understand that I don't know who wrote the rules, but when you start with threesomes or bringing other people into your bed, it's a recipe for disaster, and it will break up the current relationship. And it's this other person has chaos in their background that led to her not trusting people, and getting her involved sexually with you is going to add to the chaos. It's going to make her life more chaotic, and it's going to just destroy your relationship.
All right, but she knows it. You're going to ruin the relationship, but that's what you want to do. You do. You don't even know it, but you do.
No, I probably do know it.
You're going to screw this relationship up with your boyfriend one way or another, no matter what we tell you, right? Yeah, because you're chaotic.
Yes.
You like chaos.
True.
All right, fine. That's why you're bi, right?
Yeah, that's right.
All right, so don't get married to the guy. Don't have any kids. Get it all out of your system. See a shrink, figure it out, and then get your head screwed on straight in a few years. All right, so do it.
Why insult him?
We'll get your head screwed on now.
These two guys say the same thing I say, but I'm creepy and old.
No, I think it's cool that everybody thinks you're, like, hip. I think that's awesome. I hope I can be like you one day.
Why would I be hip if I was in my 30s? I am in my 30s. What?
You mean when you're in your 50s, like Bob, you hope that the younger generation can look at you as one of their own, right?
No, I hope people will call me up and be like, dude, you're fine.
Oh, well, whatever. Yeah, that threw me off, too, but...
Lucy...
Adam, would you just straighten out the age thing? How many years older am I than you?
I think you are... Well, the thing... Here's our...
I already said how old I am. I'm 38.
Here's our fundamental problem. Bob is only 2 years older than I am, but Bob was in show business for, like, 14 years before I got into show business. So it appears
that you're older. Yeah.
Right.
But I never looked young, you know what I mean? Like I said, I was 20 when I was on Letterman the first time. They didn't say, here's a young kid with a dream.
No, people have known you and seen you and seen, you know, movies that you're in, like Scrooge, that were, you know, how old is Scrooge now? It's like 17 years old or something?
I don't know.
It's really a compliment.
Yeah, if you look closely, I'm in the Zapruder film.
Here's what people think about you, Bob. Here's the God's honest. they think when you were on Letterman, when you were on the Tonight Show, when you were doing movies and the Police Academy and all that stuff, they figured you were probably in your mid later 20s at that time, because they're just assuming that's how old guys are when they're on these shows. The reality is you were 19, 20, and 21, and so people have taken those years and tacked it on and made you 52. That's all.
Oh, good. Now, that's a good spin. I feel a lot better.
Yeah, I'll be your publicist. Sandy?
Hello?
Hello?
You're 15. What's up?
Yeah, okay. I've had this boyfriend for, like, 3 or 4 months.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, we had sex for the first time, and he went down on me, and it was horrible. It was, like, I don't know. I told him to stop, and, like, afterwards, my clit was kind of swollen. And I don't know what that was from.
Well, what was bad about it? He didn't put out a cigar first?
No.
What happened?
No, I don't know. It just, like, hurt.
He was being too rough?
Yeah, I think, yeah, I'm pretty sure. But I don't know why it got swollen.
Well, he irritated you, probably.
Oh, okay. And I've been trying to get on your show for a long time. I listen to it all the time.
Oh, well, thanks. So, you're still going out with this guy, right?
Yeah.
Has he been down there since?
Yeah. It was better the second time. It didn't get swollen.
Right.
But I don't know what that was from. It was just weird, because that was the first time that anybody's ever done that to me.
Well, I mean, first time someone went down on you, or first time someone irritated you?
First time somebody went down on me.
I see. Well, listen, he probably wasn't exercising good technique. He probably irritated your clitoris a little bit. It got swollen. Bruce, stop me if I'm wrong.
No, very good.
And now he's smoothed out.
I'm concerned that this guy didn't stop when you asked him to stop. That's kind of a drag.
Didn't he stop?
He did. He did it for like a little bit after that, but then he stopped because I hit him on the head. I told him to stop.
Wait, did you use a table lamp or an ashtray or just your hand?
Just my hand.
Don't use a taser, because in that position, that charge will go right through you.
How old is this guy?
He's 18.
All right, so he's refining his technique now with you?
Yeah, I guess, yeah. I had also one more
thing. Hey, baby, you're 15. You can't slow it down a little bit?
Yeah, well, he was the first person I've ever had sex with, so, I don't know.
Okay, there's a real problem with you being with a guy that's 18, and there are laws against it, and there are good reasons for that. So not that I think you're going to listen, but it's not healthy for you, and especially if you're having sex with the guy. There are infections you can get, even if he just has oral sex with you. You can get a yeast infection, or you can get other
pyrrhea.
Things like gonorrhea.
That's right.
Pyrrhea.
So have you had a pelvic exam since?
No.
Have you ever had one?
No.
What kind of birth control are you using?
Step of Vera.
Really? And they didn't do a pelvic exam before they started you on that?
No.
Okay, you need to go get a pelvic exam.
Did you get a football phone when you got the phone you called us on?
Did you, who gave you the depot shot?
There's a place, this place called Joshua Tree. It's like a healthcare clinic.
And they didn't give you a checkup, they just gave you the shot, huh?
Yeah, well...
That's a real problem. It's a real problem that you're sexually active with this guy, and a lot of people assume they're on Depo-Provera, they're taking birth control pills, they don't have to use a condom, and a lot of people transmit sexually transmitted diseases that way. You can get sexually transmitted diseases just having oral sex. So there are a lot of reasons that you're in trouble, and you'll find out you're in trouble dating a guy that's 18 and you're 15. You'll realize it's a disaster, but you probably won't realize it until it's too late.
Yeah, you'll be in your 70s.
But get a pelvic exam tomorrow.
Okay, well...
Just because its swelling went down doesn't mean you're not infected with something at this point.
Hey,
can I ask you one more question?
Yeah, hurry.
I've been in counseling for, like, 2 years now.
Mm-hmm.
Because, when I was little, my dad used to, like, really beat me and my family and my mom a lot. And,
mm-hmm.
He committed suicide. My dad did.
Oh,
he took an overdose and he shot himself in the head. And it was really, like, devastating to me. And, like, I don't know, like, I can't get off on, like, a lot of things. It's,
yeah. How old were you when he did this?
Can I plug my improv date right now?
Hey.
It was from whenever I was born till I was 10.
No, but what, he killed himself when you were 10?
Yeah.
All right. Sandy, here's the deal. this is a devastating situation. You've had a real difficult life, and it's going to take some work for you to get back. You understand? You got to get some counseling. You can't just find it in older men. You can't find it through sexual expression. You have to do some work. You have to get some counseling. You got to get involved with that aspect of life. Otherwise, you're not going to have a normal life. The good news is you can do this stuff, and you can have a good life. But you have to do these things.
Do you have a counselor now?
Yeah. It's through my school. I go to the community school.
Does the counselor know that you're seeing an 18-year-old guy?
No, I haven't mentioned that.
Okay, you got to mention that, because counseling is totally ineffective unless you're perfectly honest
right.
about it. And not telling your counselor is going to sabotage the counseling.
All right, so talk to the counselor. And I was just thinking with this pelvic exam and how many women should get them and don't get them. And then I started thinking about the bookmobile. What about the pelvic exam mobile?
I should try that.
That's the old Weber's Bakery truck that's been converted into a rolling gynecologist's office.
Well, I'm sure there's guys that have that, but they're not sanctioned.
Yeah, it's a van. It says Lovetron and rainbow tape on the side of
with
it. It's got Krager mags on
with
it.
With a Frazetta painting.
Captain's Boris, I think. Captain's.
That's, it's not
Captain
a bad idea.
Seats. Yeah.
It's really not a bad idea because...
Honey, you lie down and study the rust-colored shag on the headliner, and I'll get to work.
All right, just swing the barrel seat around.
Yeah, when you hear the Uncle Henry Ahuga horn, that means it's time to come down.
It's unconscionable to start a 15-year-old on birth control without doing a pelvic. It's unbelievable. And
all right.
Sandy, you need to have a pelvic tomorrow.
All right. When we come back, we will speak to Jeb, who just got circumcised at the age of 14 and now has a rash. Hold on, real quick. Just got to circumcision, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Your parents are real procrastinators. Why did you just get it?
Converted to Jewish.
Well, I didn't really go to a professional to get it done.
Oh, great. Right, stay on the line. This is good.
Hold on.
Everybody wants to hear the end of this story.
All right, we'll take a little break. Bruce and Bobcat are here, and we'll everyone hang on to your junk because we're going to find out about this botched circumcision.
This cut rate.
Parents got a new cutlery set. Me.
After this.
Love Line. 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. And Bobcat Goldthwait is our guest tonight. He'll be down at the Irvine Improv Friday, Saturday, and Sunday this weekend. And check your local free rag to find out where he's going to be in a town near you.
This is the kid who gave himself a circumcision or something?
That's right. That is Jeb. One of the many reasons not to name your kid Jeb. Jeb?
Hi.
14.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you got a circumcision just recently.
About a month ago, yeah.
But it was a non-professional. How's that play out?
Well, I'm in this sex health class thing. Mm-hmm. And we were going over the male reproductive system. And my teacher said that sometimes if a kid isn't circumcised, males, anything, they can get the disease in there because it gets moist or whatever. Anyway.
Right.
So I read this book on circumcision.
Wow. And, you are a real self-starter, young man.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I kind of shy with my genitalia.
You're shy with it.
I don't really like, it's not one of my big things to have other people look at it and
I see.
Cut some from it.
I understand.
So, I read the whole thing on it and, I got some wire cutters.
Now, does Time...
Ooh, well, hold on a second. Hold on.
Does Time Life have, like, a book series?
I got a series,
on,
yes.
Yeah.
It comes with the Gunfighter series and the Add a Deck to Your House series.
Yeah, yeah.
So, Jeb, you got yourself some wire cutters, some dykes?
Yeah, they're pretty new and stuff and just seem sharp.
Ah!
All right.
Cheese and crackers.
Keep going.
And, so
la,
I...
La, 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 la.
I just kind of did what the book said. Oh,
what did the book say to do?
Well, it just like you cut a little hole. You know how circumcision goes, and it just went through the whole process.
Yes.
And so I did that thing.
Are you for real? You didn't? Did you pass out? Is this a crank call?
It's a mason jar call.
Well, yeah. Really painful and all, but anyway.
Well, what did you do to numb yourself?
I kind of just hung it nice for a long while until it was numb enough. So
you did what?
Hung it in ice.
Oh, you hung it in ice. You iced it.
Yeah.
I see. And then you cut it with the lineman dykes.
Yeah, and I did the whole thingamajigger.
You got all the foreskin with one snip?
Well, I did whatever it said to do. I'm kind of a blur there.
Yeah, I see. But, and then the book, it was a book about how to circumcise yourself if you're camping and you get lost.
Well,
I mean, what was the object of the book?
It was really just a book on circumcision and...
And how to do it at home?
Well, it just...
They didn't suggest using dykes, did they? They said scalpel or a sharp knife, didn't they?
Just because they say surgical steel doesn't mean you do surgery.
Well, it just said, whatever.
Okay.
I can't really remember the book.
How long ago was this?
About a month ago.
Okay.
I see. And did it work? Did you snip the foreskin off?
Pretty much, yeah. I don't know if I got all of it or anything, but now I have a rash.
Shocking. Well, you got to sue someone, maybe the manufacturer of were they Klein Tools? Is there... You can sue. I'm not sure where they're located, but I think you can sue them.
Oh.
All right. Wasn't your penis a bloody mess?
Well, kind of, yeah. I just used some toilet paper and kept it from...
I see. And what's next? A tonsillectomy, or are you going to take out your appendix? What's next?
Ty's girlfriend's tubes. Some internals.
Oh, wow.
All right. Jeb, are you a good student?
I'm good student. I'm good in school and stuff.
All right. And you don't have any what you call emotional problems? No one's ever asked you to take any medication?
No.
You never cut on yourself?
No.
No self-mutil? All right.
Okay.
Listen, you may have an issue with other people seeing your genitalia, but, you know, there's still problems you can get into. I mean, you're just lucky you didn't die of sepsis or get, you know, horrible infection and have it kill you. And God, I don't know if there's a real call or it's almost too outrageous.
I believe him.
Yeah.
I believe him. Jeb,
mm-hmm.
You're going to have to go in and let a urologist take a look at the peccaroo there.
Okay.
Or just a general doctor. I mean, with the same, you know, gumption you use to do this
right.
on yourself, you've got to be able to get up the energy and...
Or at least a union electrician.
Yeah. Now, where did you do this? What room were you in?
Well, I was just... kind of in my bedroom. I just laid out some towels. And
your parents are like, Jeb, what's going on there? Oh, nothing.
Just studying.
Well, don't worry, son. It's only natural. Like, they're thinking you're whacking off. And you're giving yourself a circumcision?
Oh, my God.
That's a message to all those dirty hippie parents that don't have their kids circumcised.
Yeah, first of all, there's
what
no...
happens.
What you're thinking about getting an infection if you're not circumcised, they're talking about people that don't have good hygiene. People that are not circumcised don't have any more problem than people that are. Unless they're very unhygienic about cleaning themselves, which
right.
most of these guys aren't. So people listening shouldn't feel like this is some dirty thing not to have a...
You know, my penis always hurts a little bit, but now it's excruciating.
Yeah, it's very difficult for most people to cut on themselves.
Yeah, I won't even wear zipper pants. You know, this guy, like, I'm all Velcro.
Yeah. No, I'm telling you, if I get a lint ball on my sack, I have to get a nurse to take it off. I can't get close to it. I can't imagine using a pair of dykes to cut my foreskin off.
No. I remember this guy, he tried to pierce his own penis, and he vomited and passed out. And then we had to take him to the hospital.
What do you use for sterilization? I'd like to know.
Oh.
You heard him. He had toilet paper. That's clean enough.
Jeb, did you sterilize the pliers before you did this?
I put it under over a flame.
I see. No alcohol in the house?
No.
Okay. All right, Jeb. I isn't this thing like a big scabby mess now?
Somewhat, yeah. It hurts to urinate.
Okay.
Well, that's
Jip, go on.
Yeah, that doesn't even go along with what you did to yourself. But all right. You need to see a doctor tonight. Go to an emergency room tonight.
Really?
Yeah,
but he's a kid.
You can see kids for any problem in that
area. All right, what does he say to the doctor?
Well, you know, you can tell the people out front you got a sore throat. You can tell them whatever you want. You just got to get a doctor to lay eyes on that.
Hey, Bruce, as an emergency physician, and everyone knows you go to the emergency room and you sit around for 6 hours, what is the good thing to tell them to get in faster? You know what I mean? Like, when you hear something, what is the one that says, this guy could be having a stroke or something?
Chest pain.
Chest pain's a good one?
If you have chest pain, they usually get you right in.
All right.
And, you know, last guy had a foreign object up his butt. It was a sore throat complaint on the chart. So people
really?
Don't...
Yeah, that's pretty far up his ass.
Yeah, it's bothering his throat.
So, and also...
What was the foreign object?
Oh, it was a wine cooler bottle.
At what brand? I think they love that kind of plug.
I got in trouble last time I mentioned the brand.
Well, I mean, different ones are different sizes. That's what I want
to
know.
But between 3 and 6 a.m., great time to go to an emergency room. Just wake up.
Was it Zima?
No, I think it was one of those new mudslide ones.
Yeah.
All right. And listen, that's a gay on top of gay. Not only something wedged in his ass, but it's a wine cooler.
Yeah, it's not like it's a bottle of gin.
Right.
A bottle of J&B.
Right, a bowling pin and you got an argument, but yeah. Wine cooler. That's gay on gay. Rhett?
Yeah, hey Adam, what's up?
Nothing.
Liza Minnelli CD lodged in my ass.
That's right.
Love the
Harvey
man show.
Firestein's beard is stuck in my ass.
Hello, what's up?
What's up, Rhett? Thank
love
you.
Love the man show, Adam.
Thank you.
Dr. Bruce, you're cool.
Thanks. Don't you think... go ahead.
Cat. Yeah.
Who do you copy more, Sam Kinison or Howard Stern?
What? I'm offended by that question.
Baba Booey.
Well, when he was in his 40s, he copied Kinison, but now that he's mellowed out in his 50s and starting to come into his 60s, he rips off Stern. That's what he's telling me off the air.
I've never seen anyone more dissimilar to those two morons than Bobcat, so
how dare you make fun of the deceased. All right, Rhett, thanks a lot for the question, everybody. Good times. Tom?
Yeah.
You're 17.
Yeah, man. My question is, see, I got a girlfriend. I started going out with her back in December. I was away at school. And then I came back home, and I'm not going back to school for a while, and she's 4 hours away. And lately I've been hanging out with my ex-girlfriend, but we, even though after we didn't go out anymore, we still slept together. And now I always sleep with her every time I see her. But, like, usually I'll be like, you know, I don't want to because I want to, you know, try to stay faithful to my girlfriend and all, but it just don't happen. It's just,
right.
I end up doing it.
Sure, you're like, weak.
Huh?
Well, the mind is willing, but the groin is weak.
Yeah.
I see, okay.
No, it's like, we'll be hanging out or whatever, and then she'll just, like, come on to me and something.
Okay. Well, why are you so far away from your girlfriend? Where are you going off to school?
Well, I was going off to school. I was at this place called Old Dominion.
I see. The college, Old Dominion?
No, it's like a job course.
Oh, yeah. Okay, this is making more sense now.
Yeah, but I started going out with this girl, and I'm sure I'm in love with her, you know? But it's like, it's just kind of hard when you got a, you know, half-naked girl standing in front of you.
Yeah, right.
Saying, come on, I mean...
All right, but listen, Tom.
Yeah.
All right, I got a couple things to say. First off, she doesn't show up at the house half-naked. I mean, you guys make dates, you make arrangements each other.
No, what happens is, like, at nighttime, she'll be like, you want to come by or whatever, and I'll go over there.
There you go. You go over there.
You know what they say, if you don't want a haircut, stay out of the barbershop, so... What's the analogy?
That, it's either that or it's just, like, I won't even hear from her for, like, a week, right?
I know, but...
She'll just show up at my door and then, you know, I can't just probably...
You know, we hate to hear you being victimized by this woman.
Tom, let's pretend she was 300 pounds and had the AIDS. Do you think you'd still have to have sex with her, or could you figure out a way not to have sex with this woman?
I wouldn't... I'd kick her out of my house, man.
Okay, but... See, there you go now, Tom.
My question is, I don't know what to do now, see, because I feel I can't barely get to sleep at night. I don't know it, like, if I should tell my girlfriend or break up with her or what, because it's kind of ruining me. Cause
Well, let's address a sleeping problem. Booze would help that.
No, I drink a lot. So.
I see, good. And, fine.
That's good. Check right, one.
Good. Quit drinking.
Smart.
You're batting 1,000. All right, listen, Tom, you shouldn't be in a relationship. You're not in love with this girl. You wouldn't be boinking the bejesus out of your ex-girlfriend if you were that much in love with her. You guys are living far apart. You're young. You guys, you don't have your own Learjet.
She's older than me, though. She's like a little bit older than me.
Well, who cares? The point is it's hard to carry on a long-distance relationship when you're 17 years old and your moped has a 30-kilometer range. You can't do it. I mean, we hear it all the time. Somebody goes off to college. Somebody moves away. They think they're going to still keep it going. It never works. It just doesn't. You have to have...
It's like, Mom, can you drive me to my date?
Right. She's in Michigan. It's not going to work. All right. So, don't get anyone pregnant. Don't get married. Break things off with the old chick and quit lying to yourself and easy on the booze. And we'll be back after this.
Hello? Who's this?
This is LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine will be right back.
It is LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Bruce filling in for Dr. Drew. And Bobcat Goldthwait is here tonight. He'll be at the Irvine Improv Friday, Saturday, and Sunday this coming weekend. And look for him in a town near you.
Yeah, and then I go to work with you.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's not like we didn't just see each other, you know, like every other day.
Yeah.
And you got to do this whole fake thing. Our old friend of the show, Bob Scratch, is in town. And, right. What are you promoting lately? It's like, Adam, we were just talking about this at lunch.
How's kicks, Bobcat? And I'll tell you, though, what a lot of people don't know about Bobcat is that he's a hell of a director. And that's why we hired him.
Yeah. And also because I'm in and out really early.
Right, he's fast.
I am fast.
Hey, that's fine. That's good.
That's, yeah. And then when we go to edit the stuff, the editor's like, do you like the first take or the first take? Yeah, there's only one take there, brother. Let's use the first part of the first take and the second part of the first take, and that'll be it.
Let me tell you, he's fast, he's efficient, the work barely suffers because of it, and yeah. That's why we like the Bobcat.
Bob Wood.
Bobby?
Yes.
Hi, what's your problem? How can we help you?
I've been having a problem actually having, like, getting an erection and then actually having the urge to have sex. Like, it's been going on for a few weeks now. And, you know, I'm only 19. This shouldn't be happening until I'm, like, 50.
Right, or 52, like Bobcat. Do you,
yeah.
Do you have a girlfriend?
Yeah.
And,
yeah, I do.
And how long have you been with her?
A couple weeks.
Well, yeah, this is early for this.
Yeah, I know.
Are you into her?
Yeah, a lot. Like, she's great.
And what's up with the penis?
I don't know. It's not up, really.
Well, have you ever had this problem before?
Never at all. Like, I used to be able to get it up on command, but now I don't know.
Well, sure, but that's when you were 17. You're 19 now, buddy. It's time to start facing facts. Your body's changing.
Yeah.
You're not able to do the same things you were able to do before.
So what sort of pattern have you had in the past? You meet somebody and you're having sex with them in the relationship within a week?
No, that's not true at all. Like, this is only the second person that I've had sex with.
Okay.
And I've really only been sexually active for a few months.
And what's your penis doing?
Nothing.
And maybe that's your penis telling you that it doesn't want to have sex with her this early in the relationship.
Well, are you on any medication right now? Hello?
Hello?
Bobby.
Are you on any medication?
I take a Naprosyn for my back. And
non-steroidal like Motrin. Not going to affect that.
That's about it.
Yeah. What's up with your back?
I've broken a few vertebrae before I played football, but
well,
it's all healed up now.
Bad times.
Occasionally.
All right. And, yeah. And the penis, you just can't get it up when you're with her.
Yeah. And I really just don't have any drive at all, really, to have sex.
Do you
like her? Are you into her?
Yeah. I mean, she's great. She's beautiful and she's a nice girl.
But, you know, the barometer for a relationship being successful or moving on is not can I have sex with this person. Sometimes it's better to wait, and I mean certainly 2 weeks. Sometimes it sabotages things just to get many times.
Right.
Most
he's 19. His penis should be working at this point.
But it's very sensitive to emotional things. It's very sensitive to a consciousness that maybe it's not the best thing.
Well, I told Drew last week that I could be getting oral sex while carrying my grandfather's casket, and my penis would work just fine.
And thank God you're not the ruler or standard for what is good and bad.
What are you talking about?
More people
will
go to a funeral.
Right. That's right.
A lot of people at the funeral.
That's right.
Do you think it's like your penis is saying, hey, easy, the ribs got to heal up before you go doing that?
It could be. I mean,
maybe you're like nervous about like it hurting. I mean, the rest of your body when you have sex.
No, it doesn't hurt at all. Like, and
is she bummed out by this?
Yeah, she's.
Ah.
Yeah, she is.
Dude.
Yeah.
But when we had sex before, it usually went like a long time, and sometimes I didn't even ejaculate.
Did you have sex with her? You mean?
Yeah.
All right, so it did work with her at one point.
Yeah.
Now, did anything change in your relationship? Do you know what I mean?
No, not that I know of, no.
I thought you met her 2 weeks ago, or you've been going out for 2 weeks?
Just a couple weeks, yeah. Like,
yeah, they had sex, it worked, and then it stopped working.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's the answer. No answer. Just stay in the relationship.
Yeah, but this guy does have a real problem.
I'd say he does. What should he do?
I don't know.
But it's 99%.
Did he like take her teeth out or something?
This age, it's not a medical thing. It's always an emotional or mental thing.
All right, so then just stay in the relationship and take it slow and see where it goes.
I would not put myself in the position where you're pressured to have sex with her. Just have a moratorium on sex for a month.
A 19-year-old football player.
Right.
Hey, let's just go out. There's a new Ivory Merchant film open up that I'm dying to see.
But once you place that there's a problem in your mind, then it becomes
I think I can.
Yeah.
Maybe he needs just a good pep talk with the penis, like the coach would give him in the locker room.
Yeah.
You
know what I mean?
Because, demonstrate that. I'm not aware of how that would
work. Well, like, first thing I'd do is say, you know, all right, penis, grab an E. You know, and then I start pacing, and I was like, what the hell was that? That's why I started yelling, what was that out there? I don't know what that was. That's not what we've been practicing. I'll tell you that right now. You went in, you were cocky, you're sure yourself. I'll tell you, it's not playing well. The balls aren't playing well, the ass is not performing, and the penis I don't even want to talk about. This is a team effort. There's no individuals in those underpants.
Who left scrotum wide open?
That's right. Now listen, let's all get a hand in. And then I give the speech. Dear Lord, please help blood rush to my penis and fill the caverns within so that I can have sex with this woman I barely know. On three. Ready? Now get out there and hump!
Oh, it's going to work. I can tell.
I don't
right
know.
There you go. Like, that is truly your gift, Adam. You're a very funny guy. No, you are. I'm not being a jerk. Is there something about my cadence that everything sounds sarcastic? Is that why the callers are all crabby towards me?
Well, it was really only one or two callers.
Yeah, but yeah, no, I know. But in my self-loathing head, they all hate me. You know,
yeah.
But I was just giving you a compliment.
Well, they love Adam so much that it's threatening.
Well, I remember like when you first started this job, and they didn't like the cut of your jib.
No, they didn't.
No, they did not. All right.
It's the hat he's wearing now, I think that's.
All right, more good radio, Bruce. We'll take a break.
Hey, well, Bruce, look at the face I'm making.
Yeah, we'll be back.
Hey, everybody, isn't that funny?
After this.
Back in a minute.
It is Loveline. I'm forget about me. And forget about Bruce. But remember, Bobcat is going to be at the Irvine Improv this weekend.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Be there. And also in parts unknown, but you may know them because they may be your parts. So
yeah, check your parts.
Check your local parts for Bobcat.
Keep the players out of your parts, though.
There you go. I want to thank Bobcat for coming in. And Bob, we'll see you either next time you're in here or tomorrow at work.
See you tomorrow at work, Adam.
All right. Bruce, a wonderful job turned in as per usual.
Oh,
and until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Bruce. Say mahalo.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.